We have already proved that Ampere's law can be represented in a differential form as curl, or the rotation of the magnetic field, would equal the electric current density J. And in its integral form, it was the integration over H to dl over a closed bus. It was the current included by this bus. And effectively, this current can be obtained as the integration of the current density J to ds, where ds is normal to the current density. So it can be represented as J dot ds. So we can replace this J by the curl of H. So in other words, we can say that the integration over a closed bus H to dl over delta S would equal the rotation or curl of H dot the normal direction to this closed bus. And by multiplying both sides by delta S, so in this case, the integration over H to dl would equal the rotation of H dot ds. This is proved based on incremental bus, which include incremental area delta S. What will be the situation if we added delta S2, delta S3, delta S4, and so on? So in this case, if we added the incremental bus delta S2, so the incremental bus delta S2, this arm would cancel this arm, and it would be the complete delta S consisting of S1 plus S2. If we added delta S3, we will find the closed bus in this case, this arm would cancel this arm, so it would be the complete of the surface area. So in general, we can generalize this to be the integration of the magnetic field over any closed bus dl would equal to the integration over the surface composed by this closed bus for the rotation of the magnetic field dot ds. And in this case, delta L is taken only on the perimeter, on the outer perimeter of the surface, because these incremental surface areas, which compose from incremental buses, each bus would cancel the corresponding one, and we have only the bus of the outer perimeter. This is defined as the Stoke theorem. So Stoke theorem states that the integration of a closed bus of any vector dot dl equals the integration over the surface for the rotation of this vector dot ds. And at this moment, we should remember the divergence theory. It was similar to that, which was the integration of any vector over a closed surface d dot ds equals the integration over the volume of, for the divergence of d dot dv. So now we have two theorems. One theorem relating the divergence operator, and the other theorem relating the curl operator. The theory which is related to the curl operator is known as Stoke theorem, and as we mentioned, states that the integration over a closed bus for any vector, shouldn't be H dot dl, equals the integration over the surface composed of this closed bus for the rotation or the curl of this vector dot the surface area composed of this closed bus. As an example, assume that we have a surface specified by r equal 4, the radius of the sphere equal 4, and theta is from 0 to 0.1 pi, and phi from 0 to 0.3 pi. So this is the assumed surface. It is part, small part of a sphere. And we have the magnetic field H is 6r sine phi in r direction plus 18r sine theta cosine phi in phi direction. And it is required to prove that Stoke's theorem is applied for this vector. So we are going to perform the integration over the closed path H to dl. Then we are going to take the rotation or the curl of this H and perform the integration of the curl dot ds for this surface area. And we see if this equals this or not. Okay? So HDL, in this case, we have the closed path is composed of three arms. Dr in r direction plus r d theta in theta direction plus r sine theta d phi in phi direction. This is dl in spherical coordinates. Now, if I'm talking about the dot product between h and dl, so the r component will be multiplied by the r component. The theta component will be multiplied by zero because we don't have theta component in the magnetic field. And the phi component will be multiplied by the phi component. So the integration of our closed path HDL would be 6r dr. H theta r d theta 0 and h phi r sine theta d phi and h r d r. This should be h r d r plus h phi r sine theta d phi plus h theta r d theta, which equals 0. And h equals 0. So we have the first component and the second component. Okay. Alright. The first component is 0. Why? Because we have a constant r. Yes. Because we have a constant r. So we are going to make the integration over r from 4 to 4. So the integration of 6r dr would be from r equal 4 to 4. So the first integration is 0. And the integration with respect to h theta is 0. So the only integration is with respect to phi. And in this case, the phi is coming from 0 to 0.3 pi. So it is 18 r sine theta cosine phi multiplied by r sine theta d phi. So 18 r multiplied by r, which is 4, multiplied by sine theta cosine phi, sine theta. Here we have taken theta to be 0.1 pi cosine phi. Cosine phi is the argument of the integration multiplied by r sine theta, r sine theta. So r sine 0.1 pi d phi. And the limits of integration would be from phi equal to 0 to 0.3. We have applied theta here to be 0.20, but effectively this surface is for the two thetas, for theta equal 0 and theta equal 0.1, but at theta equal 0 the value of sine theta would be 0. So the magnetic field at theta equal 0 is 0. So we have obtained only the magnetic field at theta equal 0.1. Okay? So the integration over HDL over closed path would be only the integration over d phi in the range from 0 to 0.3 at theta equal 0.1. And based on this, we can obtain the integration of cosine phi is minus sine phi, and we are going to take the limits from 0 to 0.3, and you multiply all these pieces together to find out the integration or the equivalent integration over the closed path would be 22.2 ampere. Okay, now the next step is to obtain the curve or the rotation of the magnetic field and multiply it by or integrate it along the surface. So the magnetic field H in spherical coordinates, so the curl of H would be 1 over r sine theta, the derivative of the phi component with respect to theta, plus 1 over r, 1 over sine theta, the derivative of the r component with respect to phi, minus the derivative of the phi component with respect to r. So this is the curl of H in its spherical coordinates. Now we obtain the curl of the magnetic field. So it has r component and theta component, but delta S in the present case is r squared sine theta d theta d phi in r direction, because it is just a simple part of the outer of a sphere, because r is constant. So r is constant means that the normal in the r direction. So delta S is r squared sine theta d theta d phi in r direction. Now by multiplying curl H by dot ds, so we are going to perform the integration over the r component only, because a theta dot ar would equal 0. So in this case the integration of curl H dot ds would be 1 over r sine theta multiplied by 36 r sine theta, so this can be eliminated with this, cosine theta cosine phi multiplied by r squared sine theta d phi, and the value of r is 4. So it is 36 cosine theta cosine phi after eliminating r sine theta multiplied by r squared, and r in the present case is 4, so 16 sine theta d phi, and the limits of integration for theta from 0 to 0.1 and 4 phi from 0 to 0.3. By performing this integration for both theta and phi, we can obtain the final form to be 22.2 amperes. So the integration for H dot dl over the closed bus is found to be 22.2 ampere, and the integration of the rotation or the curl of the magnetic field H dot ds is the same value. So in general, the rotation of H dot dl over a closed bus would equal the integration over the surface composed by this closed bus for the rotation of the magnetic field dot this surface area. And this is a numerical proof for Stoke's theorem. Okay.